So as much as this topic sounds a little esoteric, I would try to be very grounded. And I'll talk on three themes. One is a pure play CFO, conventional profit loss account, balance sheet, financial statement. The second is a glimpse of technology, what a lot of global CFOs have actually achieved in the digital world, so that once we go back, we can do something very practical and concrete. And the third thing I'll build on as a leader, how does a CFO creates an organization which is ready for a digital world? That brings me to a quick point saying that there was a very interesting book that came out last year by Professor Lay. He's a New York University professor, and the title reads like End of Accounting. That's it. His contention was that in a new digital world, that conventional accounting, the way we look at balance sheet, the way we look at P&L, does not help companies to make investment decisions. And recently, which is just last month, the Harvard Business Review, three of the professors, they released another article which says why financial statements do not work in a digital world. Today, their contention is the balance sheet represents the productive assets of the company, typically owned by the company. And their contention is the digital world, in digital companies, the assets are not necessarily owned by the companies. They could be outside the companies. And the examples could be the likes of Uber, or it could be Airbnb. They don't own assets per se. So there is no question of asset being on balance sheet, and they are valuable companies. So how do you read the balance sheet? Now, the way they have defined the asset, what are the companies investing in a digital world? And it's not applicable to only the Facebook and the Google, etc. It's applicable to industrial world companies investing heavily in digital transformation. So here are the key things that they are investing in, which are termed as a productive assets, which lead to productive revenue at some point of time and the valuation, which are research and development, customer social relationship, peer network, technology, and human capital, right? Predominantly, you'll be able to relate. Now, if you look at this list, the interesting part of the list is, in a conventional wisdom, in our balance sheet, when we define assets, assets depreciate with use. That's the accounting. Agree? But in a digital world, every time a new user or a customer joins the company's network, its value goes up for the other customers. So actually, it's called network effect. The value goes up. With usage of company's asset, the value of asset goes up, which means a negative depreciation. Do our accounting systems allow for negative depreciation? That's a fundamental thing. Now, from P&L, from balance sheet, they have moved to P&L. And they said, when the companies are investing in all these assets to build their future, that is not capitalized. That's not allowed to be capitalized. And it shows in an expense side. It shows an expense side with no commensurate revenue for years. And therefore, they show a loss. Right? And you see the loss-making companies going public with billions of dollars. At some point of time, when the network effect becomes huge and they have already made investment in it, they start capitalizing and getting the revenue, which is a pure play profit, which is a Facebook example, which turned the corner and now having an operating profit of 76% on a 48 billion revenue. So that's called a critical point in which they shift to this side. So the takeaway from this, what we were trying to say is that, look, as CFOs, one of the things one need to look at is that our conventional thinking, is it applicable? We are going to take day-to-day decisions in a digital world, even for industrial organizations. Is that required to be questioned? Second thing, when I said that, please do not interpret it as meant for Twitter and Facebook. Today, if you look at the data, last year, the total investment in productive assets made in US in intangible assets already surpassed the total investment made in physical assets, plant, machinery, equipment. Last year, it has already crossed. And it's not the Google and Facebook making investment. It's lots of tons of industrial organizations making digital investment. And I would like to pick a thread on this list on a peer and supplier network. and say something, this is great, one theme, we have only 15 minutes, go back and you can build on it. But what can we do? I'll quickly talk about four or five technology themes, how people like yourself, people in the room, and I meet a lot of CFOs in the region, how they have taken and transformed their organization. Something that we all do day in, day out. I'm not talking about any, like I was pleasantly surprised to read a few months back, Federal Bank of India tied up with Lulu Exchange of Dubai to transfer the remittances to India quicker, faster, safer way from leveraging the blockchain technology. I'm not saying that we necessarily go to that depth. I wish we do, but let's talk mundane on the supplier network. The fact today is that over times, the value that any organization adds for its end customer has moved from within the four wall of the company to outside the four wall of the company, which is where the 70% value lies. And we spoke about the digital platform network effect valuation driven. And a lot can be done here. As CFOs, are we focused in this area? Are we thinking digital? A lot of time I have spoken to CFOs, and most of the time I have heard digital for customer interaction. But 70% of the key lies outside the company. Let me share some flavor of what it means. Here is a consumer packaged company, global packaged company, and I want a show of hands to ask you, how many of you in your companies have total variety of product, we call stock keeping unit, a variety of product, which is more than 15, 20 types of product? Show of hands. Many. And you would know that more the variety of products, which is going to be the norm in future, the more complex it is to manage the business, the more you will end up in mismatch of inventory, more inventory on balance sheet, right, and more missed sales. So this is a company which makes, we are talking about 20, they make total 31,000 type of product, 31,000 variety. As CFOs, you would imagine what it can do for business, right? Selling in 190 countries. The issue with the same this company was when they orchestrate the whole supply based on the dynamic demand, they always land up in mismatch and unwanted inventory and also losing sales. What did they do? They actually digitally transformed this entire supply in terms of planning, doing two things. Number one, the dots that you see represent the constraint in supply chain, which means in real time, as they do the planning with the digital platform, they were able to find in 60 minutes time of any plan, is my supply base ready to deliver on this plan here and now? Because constraints are not for life, constraints are in real time, right? Imagine what it could do to planning. If I know right now that one of my suppliers somewhere cannot deliver this product, I can change my plan, right? Number two, with digital platform, they got the visibility of inventory across supply chain, which includes supply chain inventory of their company to their supplier, entire visibility. What was the result? This company, within 12 months of starting this journey, got $300 million off their balance sheet, $300 million, with 15 million cost of goods sold reduction and 5% improvement on time in full. That's the power of digital, that's the power of supply side digital transformation. The second example I'll give with the airline industry, this company, it's a global airline, did a fantastic job around 8-9 years back in negotiating terrific contracts. Airlines buy crew accommodation, they buy in-flight catering, they buy tons of MRO, they buy lots of stuff. But what their CFO discovered over time, that in spite of their team doing a wonderful job, their actual buying was reasonably off contract. And Hackett study says that any organization, almost 4.4% of the buying happens off contract, even if you negotiate the best contract, right? They also found that there was a big pain in the user community. They had no visibility or clue what's happening to their request. Timelines were bloated, so it was a pretty big mess, right from compliance. What they did is they digitally transformed the way they will interact with the supplier and the end users, brought them together in something that looks like it. I won't get into detail in the interest of time, but have a look and feel. This is what their end users started seeing in a digital world. And one click, they started seeing this. I'm keeping it simplified version. The second view is world has gone mobile. This is the view. The end user sitting here, just like Amazon selects the thing, and say, this is what I want to buy, goes to the manager, approval sitting, different part of the world, one click says yes. Within 30 seconds, it appears on the mobile of a supplier saying, yeah, this is the order I need to ship. Imagine what happens to the timeline. Imagine digital, imagine agility. What's the bottom line for CFO? That's the question CFOs ask. This is the bottom line. Their compliance, when they did the study later on, contract compliance went up to 96%. And in the value term, it was 483 million pounds saving over 18 months. Employee productivity, 48%. In digital, you remember original discussions. We are not talking about 5%, 10%. We are talking 48%. Cycle time reduction, 60%. You can imagine one click to one click to one click. From end user sitting in UK to the supplier sitting in Taiwan and in between wherever the manager is. And visibility, complete visibility. Everybody knows where my status is. The third example I'll share, which is very dear to heart of a lot of people, and I'm hearing from a lot of CFO this topic on the forefront, business risk. Everybody is worried about business risk. One of the leading FMCG company in their annual report recently came out with three things: financial capital, social capital, environmental capital. I'm quoting straight out of their annual report, leading financial company. So this is the forefront. People are worried about this risk. And the crux is that a lot of risk originate from your supply chain. Somebody sitting somewhere takes some action which impacts your reputation, right? Whether it's a, I was talking to one of the fiber company and their worry was, we want to source the pulp and we are worried that pulp can come from the wood which is a protected forest, and if that news leaks, it impacts my brand. That was a key concern. And what all these risks are spread out. So what these companies showing on the left, the oil and gas company and leading pharma company and Australia-based mining, metal and mining company, what they did is they established a digital platform to track 280 types of risk incidents in real time from 600,000 sources, which is World Bank report, which is the World Economic Forum, country risk, etc. Imagine this is not humanly possible, it's all digital. And with that, this is how their CFO got the dashboard saying risk categorization, then by category they get into the, and they can get into the specific supplier and act proactively. Finally, where rubber meets the road, CFOs are worried about business continuity, brand, business reputation. This is how they have used digital for this purpose. The next example I would take is more day-to-day finance. In the first session, we were talking about transaction, but I straight get into the point. Here are the type of industry, and a lot of industries which I've done it. A typical finance problem, tons of invoices come inside the company, and today the exception rate when you do validation and match run into somewhere around 18 to 40%, leading to huge cycle time to approve invoices, which is a big concern in a GST regime. And productivity in India, around 8,000 to 12,000 invoices per person per annum. I don't know what's the standard for your company, but when you do the digital transformation of this entire thing, this is how the graph would look like. This is the extent, and this is a globally consistent thing. 2 to 3% exception. Imagine all the invoices that come to your company, only 2 or 3% are identified with exception. Rest are okay to pay. Cycle time reduced to 2 to 3 days. Alcoa, cycle time reduced from 21 days to less than 3 days consistently. Numerous example. Productivity goes up to 40,000. The extreme example is Disney, 48,000 invoices per account payable person per annum. That's the level of productivity. So Kimberly Clark, CFO, got a brilliant idea. He said, my God, so much of a cycle time has been reduced. This is a new opportunity. Because the invoices are approved, I don't have to pay. And he started a working capital collaboration program, creating so much of a money with the discounting that they term their account payable from cost center to a profit center. So that's what the power of it. Kimberly Clark, a very famous global study. I won't spend time on it. Lots of companies are doing it, cost reduction, and we are here with our partner CloudWays, and a lot of companies have done it, including some Indian example. But I'll move on to the last topic because we are almost up the town time, saying that as CFO, as leader, what can you do when you go back? The biggest charter for CFO is to design the organization for the digital world, to survive in a digital world, to thrive in a digital world. The organization needs to be redesigned. And redesigning give a glimpse. I won't talk about the strategy. We spoke enough about these statements and what digital can be done. But structure, the jobs are getting to be eliminated. You need to be aware there will be a lot of resistance from people. There's a study by McKinsey by 2030, 800 million jobs will vanish only by artificial intelligence. Now, we need to deal with the topic sensitively. What can we do? How can we gear our team to redeploy in newer job, which means newer skills? So what are the new skill? World Economic Forum Labor Report came out with the top 10 skill in 2018. And you know what are the top four skills? Critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, emotional intelligence. Can you believe? Are you creating the skills for your team? Are you helping your team to survive? Or will they risk loss of job? Coming back to hiring, it starts right from the time you hire. And again, there was a the CEO of EY was interviewed in Davos, and he was asked that he said that, look, we hired 65,000 people last year. We're going to hire similar people this year. And when I go to the campus, we tell the people, guys, we are hiring you for a job that does not exist in my company today. And you will be asked to use technology that have not been created till now, solve the problem that we don't know. And that underlying tone was, we are hiring for digital quotient. We are hiring for attitude and no more skill. Are you creating your organization, getting it ready for that? The last is process. I won't delve into it. In the new world, the processes like design thinking, innovation lab, collaboration with the supplier, collaboration with startups will be crucial. You have to embed it in the organization. And the last part, and I heard the panel discussion about culture a lot. This is my favorite. This is the top one. And only one thing I want to talk about it. How do we encourage people to take risk, do experimentation, do it fast, fail fast? Number one. Number two, are we allowing and encouraging actively people to question everything, every status quo? And here I would talk straight to the CFO community. I think the perception, right or wrong, is that this is where things need to move better, because otherwise there's no innovation, right? So I would sum up with the last slide just to show that the single charter on culture for your company to survive and thrive in a new world, please shatter the mindset that I'm showing. Thank you very much.